Welcome to the QI office party. Joining me around the photocopier for a show all about offices and occupations are Vice President of Stapler Affairs, Deirdre O'Kane. Senior partner in charge of biscuits, Richard Osman. Regional branch biro lid replacement manager, David Mitchell. On the 15th year of his two-week internship, Alan Davis! Let's hear their noises, office. Deirdre goes. What is it?
Thanks for the help.
Well done.
Wow.
This must be a historian.
But genuinely, kids at home are going, oh, that's good.
Yeah, Richard goes. It's a laugh from a certain section of the audience. Which I like. David goes.
Diarrhea.
And Alan goes.
The office is now closed. Please leave a message for
Alan Davis.
After the tone.
Right. What's the worst thing you can catch in the office?
Well, I mean, the plague.
You imagine how many days off people had during the plague. People are perfectly all right. Yeah. Oh, God. Plague. Yeah. pretty bad.
What, were they just talking to their hands?
Yeah.
They were just.
Files disease?
Files disease. Well, in fact, it's bad manners. Bad manners is the thing you are most likely to catch in an office. They did a study in 2015, and acts of rudeness apparently spread around an organisation a bit like a cold. And when rudeness starts, it tends to get worse over the course of a working day.
Oh, bugger off.
Actually catch bad manners.
Well, apparently what happens is if somebody is rude to you, you are more likely to be rude back. So it is one of the things you are most
hence
likely to...
Hence the Nazis and things like that.
Started in an office.
Yeah.
Someone being a little bit impolite.
Yeah.
Over some filing.
And suddenly they're in Poland.
The next thing...
There is lots of bacteria as well. I mean, they did a study of 33 keyboards in an average office and one of them had five times as many germs as the office toilet seat.
But I'm always a bit worried about those numbers of germs things, because they say the average kitchen worktop has more germs on it than the average loo seat, to which the obvious response is, well, that's obviously broadly fine then.
Yeah.
Because we're not all dying. We don't go to the kitchen, have one meal and immediately vomit and vomit and vomit.
The toilets are actually quite clean because they are actually cleaned with bleach, which is... I do not think bleach is the perfect product of all time. Because people go to the shops, they buy it, they pour it down the toilet, they flush it away and they go and buy some more. Whoever invented it thought, this is going to make us a fortune. So, Peter, what do you reckon, if you had an all-male office and an all-female office, which one would have more bacteria?
Oh, the male.
Why?
Because you're mankier than us.
So, weirdly, that is the scientific answer. They're dirtier and bigger, so they give off more bacteria.
But are men dirtier per kilogram?
Oh, that's a good question. Deirdre, how dirty are you? And then we'll work it out.
I know that men don't wash their hands after they've been in the toilet.
There you go.
In fact, I was once at Wembley Stadium and I went to wash my hands. And when I got to the sink, there were three penises urinated into the sink.
No! On their own? Works.
They couldn't be bothered to queue for the urinals. They just used the sink where I was trying to wash my hands. And they're here tonight.
Did you ever play the old Comedy Store?
Yes, I played the old Comedy Store. And I went, the first time I went in the dressing room, Arthur Smith and Paul Merton were in there. And they introduced themselves and into the toilets over there. And it was the sink.
Yeah, so it was there was just a basin in the corner of the room and they
not
weren't
much...
really expecting girls.
I was just going to say, not much good for us.
No, but, well, Josie Lawrence used to lift me up. So while we're on the difference between boys and girls. Does anybody know why air conditioning in offices is sexist?
Is it because males and females like different room temperatures?
It's because when it was first set, they did some tests in the 1960s and they specifically set the temperature for an 11-stone, 40-year-old man. And it's been set at that.
There's no
kind
such
of
thing as that anymore, is there? An
11-stone, 40-year-old man. But it, so it was set at that, and I don't know his name. If I catch him, I'm going to kill him. But women's metabolisms run so much slower, so we don't have as much muscle, we don't generate as much heat, so we're much colder in offices than men, for whom the air conditioning is all organised. There is good news. If you feel cold at work, if you feel cold on a Monday, why might it be better on a Friday?
The excitement of the weekend makes everyone get a little bit...
You've been in the office for 5 days, you get used to it?
Well, it's that you've been in the office for 5 days and it has got warmer by the generation of all those people coming into the city. They did some studies in Melbourne and the temperature actually went up 0.3 degrees in the entire city by just people coming in over the course of the week.
Not just because it's Melbourne and it's warmer there.
Well, I never thought of that as an answer. I think that's fair. The worst thing you can catch in the office is bad manners, unless you work in a virus laboratory, I imagine. So, I have four occupations for you. Deirdre, you are a sewage diver. Richard, you're the Queen's bagpiper. David, you're an ornamental hermit. And Alan, you're bailiff of the Chiltern Hundreds. Which of you has got a real job?
The Chiltern Hundreds is a real place.
Yes, but is the job a real job?
It's an anti-job. It's what you get when you resign as an MP, join the Chiltern Hundreds.
So it's not really a real job. So 1624, they passed a law saying that nobody can leave Parliament. And it stems from the time when people were elected against their will. So sometimes local gentry were made to join Parliament. They didn't really want to. And the law says technically you have to die or you have to be voted out or you have to go and work for the Queen or something. So if you want to retire, you apply for a fictional Crown office called the Steward and Bailiff of the Chiltern Hundreds. And here are some people who have, in their time,
look at
stewards.
Tony Blair pretending to drink wine.
He brought an empty glass to his lips and now he has filled it with his special liquid. Then he passes it to the person next to him, they drink it, and then they like him.
So let's go back to the sewage diver. What do you reckon? Did it a real job?
Well, it's a shit job, isn't it?
Look at that. It is a real thing.
So they have a wading.
But that's not a way to resign if you're an MP. You know, I think that would be quite popular.
That would be a good way.
I wish to leave politics, so now I will immerse myself in excrement.
Yes.
Hooray!
Who would do this job?
I used to be a sewage diver. It was just going through the motions.
Well, there are sewage farms and they have sort of moving parts, and when things get stuck, they're fitted with air pipelines. They have to dive in and climb down to fix them.
Oh, fitted with air pipelines. I would hope so.
Yes, I am. Just take a deep breath and go for it. I would have thought the worst job is the person who has to clean the suit when they get out.
I don't know. I think I'd go presented with that terrible career choice. I think I'd go for cleaning the suit.
Queen's bagpiper, Richard, is that a real job?
Well, she's got everything, hasn't she? The Queen. So, yeah, gosh, I'd imagine so.
She is really keen on bagpipers, isn't
she? Well, she inherited it. Queen Victoria was terribly keen. I mean, mad keen.
Mad for the bagpipes.
Yeah. There was no telly then, so, you know, fair enough.
Perhaps it was much easier in the days when all you had to be better than was a bagpiper.
Yeah. 9 o'clock every morning, he plays for 15 minutes underneath her window.
Oh, no, he doesn't.
Well, he's been told it's her window. I have who knows which. They play 15 minutes every day at Buckingham Palace, Windsor Castle, Balmoral or Holyrood House. They don't play at Sandringham. Anybody know why?
Because she needs a break. That's the Christmas one, isn't it, Sandringham?
Yeah. Well, apparently it's because there isn't enough accommodation. So...
Sorry, we just don't have the room for the bagpiper.
One of the things they say...
This is kind of anti the Christmas story, is it?
They're in the stable.
Apparently, and you'll be appalled by this, at Christmas at Sandringham, some of the royal family have to sleep in the servants' quarters. I don't know where the servants go.
Well, presumably that involves them seducing a servant every evening.
And when he's not bagpiping, he's a page of presents, but I have no idea what that is.
A page of presents is Santa's list, isn't it?
I'm going to give you an extra point, because that's the cutest answer anybody's ever given. What about the ornamental hermit, David? What do you reckon?
I think, didn't the sort of very rich, mad aristocrat that built Follies might think a folly would be even more fun if it was permanently inhabited by someone employed to sort of be there and be hermit.
You're absolutely right. It was very fashionable in the 18th century, and they liked people to sort of dress up as druids, and they lived in caves. If the landowner couldn't afford a hermit, because, you know, they're pricey, they saved money by having just the hermitage and telling everybody the hermit was out.
Which, famously, hermits never are.
No.
I would have gone with, don't bother the hermit, he's a bit of a loner. That's more plausible, isn't
it? Well, there are still several towns in Europe that have professional hermits. So, early 2017, the Austrian town of Saalfelden advertised for one. There's no salary, but you get your own house and chapel, which is very nice. There's no TV, no running water, no internet, and you need to be sociable.
You need to be sociable.
Yeah, because people turn up.
You wouldn't expect that. You've finally made it as a professional hermit, and then there's of course, the main thing is you've got to be sociable.
2008 survey, most common job title in the UK.
Job title?
Yeah.
Party planner?
No. Balloon animal magician?
I wanted to be that.
Is it just an office worker?
It's manager.
That's a lot of managers.
It is.
Most of them have been England managers as well.
Is that a football joke?
Yeah.
Okay. Anyway, moving on. Why shouldn't you give a teenage boy your phone?
Just plain hygiene. Don't want to give a teenage boy anything, do you?
I'm not happy with anyone having my phone.
Oh, why?
My phone broke a few weeks ago, and it was like I'd lost a hand. In fact, I gained one. Because I could use two. I felt genuinely bereft. I think having something you can stare at, and by staring at it, you look like you're gainfully occupied.
Yeah.
And so people might leave you alone. It's a way of being a hermit wherever you are.
Actually, we are going back to the 19th century. It's the very first telephone systems. Bell Telephone, 1878. If a call came in, they actually had to put a plug into the hole that the call was being received and then run a wire to where the call wanted to go. And when they first set up this system, they hired messenger boys because it was assumed that it was a physically demanding job and the boys would be fantastic at it, they'd be really fit. Instead, they drank beer and wrestled each other, swore at the customers and connected strangers together as a prank.
What if the first social network?
Yes.
I was going to say, what if this is what the internet is? Well, you think it's this whizzy thing, but it's actually just a series of teenage boys in a little bunker kind of
dressed like that.
It would explain a lot about the internet if it was.
Yeah. And so the boys were very quickly replaced by women. By the end of the 1880s, almost all phone operators were women, and they could always remember who they were speaking to. They had to say number please about 1,000 times a day. They were polite and they managed to knit at the same time. This is the original multitasking.
And yet the toilet was still a sink.
The phone banks, you can see how long they are in the picture, that some of the women used to wear roller skates in order to make their way up and down. Fantastic picture. Anyway, another occupation now. How would an onion Johnny bring tears to your eyes?
Is he wearing one there?
No, it's not a thing.
It's not a thing.
No.
So it's an emotion.
Oh, what is the emotion of onion Johnny?
It's a sad emotion, obviously. It brings tears to your eyes.
Because it's making you cry. An ennui, maybe.
You're heading in the right direction.
Okay, really? Blimey.
In that we've managed to get a cod French accent in.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
So it's French.
French heading towards France.
French, but it's not a thing.
It's a person.
Is it a person selling onions?
It's a person selling onions. Yeah. Absolutely right, Deirdre. Very well done. So they were French onion sellers who travelled door to door. In the 1920s and 30s, there were up to 1,500 of them who travelled to the UK for several months of the year, mostly on bicycles, and they were called Johnnies, because they were Jean. A lot of them are called Jean, so they were onion Johnnies. And it's where we get the origin of the French stereotype, the beret and the stripy jumper. But in fact, they were Bretons. They were from Brittany. So most French people are baffled by the fact that we think this is what a Frenchman looks like. because most of the Johnnies didn't speak French at all. They spoke Bretonese, which is a bit like Welsh. 2008 reported only 15 onion Johnnies remain. Does anybody know the myth that if you put half an onion in your sock, within half an hour you'll be able to taste it as the chemicals run through your body?
Why would you eat your sock?
No, you don't need to eat the sock. You put the onion inside the sock to keep it in place, and then the chemicals seep up through your body.
Nonsense, I don't believe it.
It is nonsense. One of the elves tried this and it doesn't work, and what worries me is that they tried it.
They do very thorough research.
I heard that if you fill your shoes with custard, you can taste it after half an hour, yeah. And that's a fact.
Don't say that. Squelching elves.
If they're watching.
I've heard if you put beef stroganoff in your socks, you can taste it after 6 weeks. So you're really going to stick at that one.
Sometimes they make you cry and sometimes they don't they?
Yes, and there are all sorts
There's
of
reasons for that.
I think it's the way in which you cut them.
Something to do with that, and also whether your partner's just left you.
There's no point in putting a spoon in your mouth then, is there?
I do that. Put yeah. a silver... Do you put a teaspoon
you're
in your mouth?
You're meant to put a spoon in your mouth. When you're chopping the onion, you put a spoon in your mouth and you won't cry, but it doesn't work.
A teaspoon or a big, great big spoon, like a ladle?
No, like a... Say a dessert spoon.
Spoon size.
And do you have it curvy bit up or down?
I'd have the curly bit up in the shape of the palate.
Don't ask Deirdre, it doesn't work for her.
Have you ever played the spoon game?
What's the spoon game? The
spoon game is you put a spoon in your mouth, a bit like that.
Yeah.
Hurt. Put your head down. Put your head down. Won't hurt.
Put my what?
Your head.
Head down.
Right, you got it up. Right. Then. David, you can get up now.
Thank you.
Then David will put the spoon in his mouth and I'll put my head down.
Yeah.
And then a third person behind me will hit me with incredible force with another spoon. And it really, really hurts.
Yes.
So when you come up, you're enraged. And then you put the spoon back in your mouth and you really, really try as hard as you can. And then they say, right, and then the third person, kiss. And it took me 3 goes. Before I thought, hang on a minute, you're not doing that with the spoon in your mouth.
What worried me is how compliant David was. You had no idea.
I was just trying to look fun.
I've known you a long time, David. It's a new look.
Yeah.
Now, for an out-of-office question, how do you get everyone to leave the office party?
Fire alarm.
Fire alarm's good.
Sprinklers.
I'm going to give you a clue. It's a particular office that we are going to be in. It's going to be the Oval Office.
Tell him the President's on his way.
So, the President of the United States, it was a tradition that he held an open house to celebrate the inauguration. And theoretically, anybody could show up and shake the President's hand and drink a bit of punch. So, 1829, Andrew Jackson, he had a tradition of, you know, having people over, and it was the worst house party ever. 20,000 people showed up, massive crowds poured in, they stood on the furniture, they ground food into the carpet, they broke the crystal, and apparently the carpet smelled of cheese for months. So, how to get the guests out of the house? So, the house has got 20,000 people in it, they're all making the place stink of cheese. What did you
do? Fire.
No, you want to lure them. Be nice.
Ice cream van.
Ice cream van in 1829. Mm. I'm loving the idea.
So I'm sorry. Ice cream cart.
No, they set up huge barrels of whiskey on the lawn.
Oh.
Free booze.
We've had so much cheese.
But he didn't learn, Jackson. So 1837, he's done 8 years in office, and he leaves office, and he's been given as a gift this massive half-ton wheel of cheese by a farmer.
A half-a-ton
wheel of cheese. Yeah. And he thought, we'll have that as a party. 10,000 people turned up and ate this cheese in 2 hours And once again, the White House stank of cheese, apparently.
Simpler times when all you need for a great party is just an unbelievable quantity of cheese. Don't even need biscuits.
No. So the truth is, most people don't look forward to their office parties. They did a survey, 700 office workers, 25% did look forward to it, 40% didn't care, 20% actively hated the prospect. And 15% couldn't be asked to answer the question, I think.
I think you have to be quite socially confident to say you're looking forward to your office party. It sounds a bit keen.
Yeah.
You're supposed to dread it or go, oh, it'll be fine. So those 25% are either very socially confident or they've completely missed the mood of the times.
Yeah. Quick question about the Oval Office. Can you spot the fascist in the Oval Office?
Oh.
It's a thing. This is an actual thing.
A thing.
It's the thing from which we get the word fascist or fascism. It's that bundle there that you could see over the door. So what it is, it's a bundle of wooden rods. It's often shown with an axe. When Mussolini came to power, he adopted it as the symbol of fascism, so it's where we get the word from. It's a big thing for the Americans. There are two fascies on the seal of the United States Senate, and they also had them on their coins. Throughout the Second World War.
The Washington Monument is the tallest building in Washington, D.C. No other building is allowed to be more than 12 stories or something like that.
Yeah. It was much disputed over because they couldn't decide who was going to pay for it. So they built a bit of it and then it stopped. And by the time they finished building it, they didn't have the same marble. So you can see a line where the dispute kind of took place.
Once you get above a certain height, you can just use breeze blocks.
No, I always spot that. Always. People always build their fences to like an inch lower than my eyesight, and they honestly they think they're safe from everybody.
But you know,
they're not safe from me. The trampolines I've seen.
That's a brilliant title for your autobiography.
But you know what, Ben? We've got a wall that goes onto public space, and the limit that we're allowed to erect to is 2 metres, which is a very close approximation of your height. Yeah.
So the law about your wall height is specifically designed to allow Richard to see in.
Oh, it's for us to see Richard should he approach.
Yeah.
Right, moving on. Name the world's biggest troll.
Donald Trump.
Katie Hopkins.
Hey!
Donald Twitter. Oh, no, that doesn't make sense.
Piers Morgan.
Piers Morgan. No, we've gone offshore, so it's not a Twitter thing, it's an offshore thing.
Do trolls live under oil rigs now? Who's that clip-clopping over?
Troll A, gas platform in the North Sea's Troll gas field. It's the tallest and heaviest structure ever moved by mankind. It weighs over 1 million tons and it is taller than the Empire State Building. So,
is it?
Normally, this is before it's been taken out.
Shut the front door.
I know! Taller than the Empire State Building. This is before it's been taken out to sea, so when it is out at sea, you can't actually see the central structures there. It takes 9 minutes to take the lift down the leg.
Whereupon you drown.
The singer Katie Melua received a Guinness World Record for the deepest concert ever given when she played 303 metres below sea level in the leg.
So they have a performance space at the bottom of the troll leg thing.
Yes, but I
think that shouldn't have got funding. I think they're going to... That's too much money in gas, isn't there?
Yeah. But I think it's, strictly speaking, called the dining room. It's not like a club. And you couldn't have a board outside saying what's on because it would get washed off every night.
Would you not get the bends?
It'd be pressurised in there.
It's not only is it as a sub-aqua performance space, it has to be pressurised.
Yeah.
You can see why the boat remains the more cost-efficient way of having something on the surface of the sea.
Yeah.
Rather than it being on a huge concrete leg with a concert hall in it.
And when all that's done, is there a tiny little gas tap at the top like you had for a Bunsen burner? Yeah. A million ton structure, and then you go.
They use it like the cigarettes.
When we went for a cigarette at lunchtime at school, we went and stood round the back of the Shell garage. I shit you not, that was... that was where we went for a cigarette. Got up the garage. And we go and smoke on the forecourt.
Safety first. I love it. Now, for a 00 occupation, can you name the longest-lasting Soviet spy to work in the UK?
Oh, yes.
Yes.
My friend Steve. I shouldn't say that, actually. But that is... but it is him.
It was a secretary called Melita Norwood, and she had a job in a metals firm in London that was heavily
involved. Just have to look at her.
I know, you can tell straight away.
To be fair to her, she did. Yeah. She spent a while in Slade as well.
Doesn't she look a bit like Richard, though?
You know what her main tactic was? Mm. Peering over people's walls.
I get Vladimir Putin with me all the time. Tell me about the trampoline. Tell me.
Whose arm's a trampoline?
Yeah. Does Ellen Davis have ever Wendy house?
It just shows you it's worth another layer of bricks, isn't it? When you're building a wall around MI6.
Yep. Just check it out.
How tall can someone be? 6'2" maximum.
She worked in a metals firm that was heavily involved in Britain's atomic project, and every night she used to open her boss's safe and she used to photograph the contents, and thanks to her, the Soviet Union were able to test their nuclear weapons much sooner. And she was discovered as a spy in 1999 when she was 87 years old, and the authorities decided there was no point in prosecuting her. And she was, of course, nicknamed the Bolshevik of Bexley Heath. Which is a hideous error, because obviously a Bolshevik is a male word. Should have been Bolshevichka.
Also, she lived in Stafford. So.
Yeah. One of the least effective spies, Britain's Michael Bettany, hired by MI5 in 1982. He once tried to dodge a ticket on a train while drunk, and when a guard chased him, he shouted, "You can't arrest me, I'm a spy."
So easy to overestimate the efficacy of the double bluff, isn't it?
Yeah. Well, he later tried to get in touch with the KGB to sell them some documents, and the KGB thought they were being set up, and they informed MI5 of his treachery. So he was just rubbish.
Look, that is the worst bunny rabbit you've ever seen.
Probably the worst spying operation happened in 1940, and this is one of my favourites. A dozen German spies landed in Britain, and they were all caught almost immediately. One walked into a pub and asked for a pint of cider soon after 9 o'clock in the morning. They weren't allowed to serve alcohol before lunch.
Half a litre of cider?
Straight away, please. Another couple were stopped while cycling through Scotland on the wrong side of the road, and when they looked in their bags, they found to contain German sausages and Nivea hand cream.
And I thought, what a combination!
I know.
It's 9 o'clock in the morning.
I've had a cider, Hans.
British soldier would have hand cream, but it turns out Nivea's German. I didn't know that.
Did is it?
It's German.
Oh.
One of them spoke no English at all, but the one who spoke English the best said his mission was to find out how the people is living, how many soldiers there are, and all the things.
Really, I know it was a documentary, basically.
There are some people who think they were deliberately sent by senior German officers to sabotage the plot because they didn't want to invade Britain. But,
That's the Germans for you. At the time.
Come the time.
A lot of them have mended their ways since.
No, a lot of them have. For our friends in Berlin, Richard's address is...
He's just bitter because they have really, really high fences.
But I'll tell you, that Berlin Wall... Oh,
now, what is this man about to post?
A letter.
Is he about to post a Movember selfie on Facebook?
No, but this is the most extraordinary thing. He's about to post himself.
Is he?
Yeah. His name is Willie Reginald Bray. He was also known as the Human Letter. He was an eccentric gentleman who spent his entire life pushing the British Post Office to their absolute limits. And he started by sending unwrapped stamped objects to himself to see how that would go. So he sent a shirt collar and a half-smoked cigar. That's him actually posting onions on the right there. He sent a turnip with the address carved into it, a rabbit skull with the address written along the nose bone, with the stamps glued onto the back. And almost all of it got through without any trouble at all, so he began to experiment. He wrote to any resident of London. There it is, any resident of London. Sadly, that was rejected, insufficiently addressed. But he did get his mother to crochet the address, and that was accepted. And he also wrote the address in mirror writing, and that was also accepted. And then he discovered in the post office guidelines that you could send a live animal, as small as a bee, if you wanted to, through the post. So he couldn't get a bee, he settled on his dog. And then finally he sent himself through the post. He shipped himself to his father, and there's his rather irritated father receiving him. Then he decided to build the world's largest collection of autographs. He wrote to the Reichstag in Germany so many times. There's a letter back from Adolf Hitler's office. Please, can you stop sending letters? The Führer's quite busy.
What if that finally pushed Hitler over the edge?
Yeah.
As I say, a lot of them these days, very different. A very different country.
Yeah. Just keep digging that hole there, Richard.
It's not a hole, it's a trench. I'm just saying keep an eye on them, that's all I'm saying.
Right, moving on. Now it's time for Alan's occupational hazard, the round that we all call general ignorance. Fingers on buzzers, please. Who do you go and see to get your eyes tested? David.
Optician.
Oh.
Alan Davis.
Optometrist.
Yes, so the optician dispenses the glasses and the optometrist is the person who actually tests your eyes. You can be trained as both. So if you might have an optician who's also an optometrist, that is possible.
An optician who's also an optometrist, that's a TV show I'd like to watch. Crazy maverick optician who does optometry as a sideline. There is an optician where I live, and it's called Maverick and Wolf.
Wow.
An optician. I don't think that's their real names.
I think it is their real name.
What do you think?
Yeah.
Because it's an odd thing to invent, isn't it? Why would you want to buy glasses from people so oddly named?
Branding, David. Do you understand the concept of branding?
Mitchell and Webb is a disastrous name.
Mitchell and Webb is a good name for an optometrist.
Yeah, that's
actually, that it does much sound better. It does sound like an optician's.
Maybe one of each.
Yeah. Oh,
yes. Yeah. They can't get on.
Why might poor eyesight make a good impression?
Do you seem aloof and therefore people respect you?
When you can't see them,
yeah,
you don't rear back at their hideousness.
Or try and jump them because of their beauty.
Yeah.
So either way, your response is muted.
It's not that.
I have very bad eyesight, even with glasses, so I can see virtually nothing. But it does mean, you know, in all the Hollywood movies when they used to sort of, yeah, I see. Can I say thank you very much? So everyone looks like they're shot through a filter.
Okay, but so this is about that. It's to do with impressions.
Oh, is it because Monet and Manet had bad eyesight and that's
it's
what they painted?
It's absolutely to do with the many of the impressionists suffered from very poor eyesight. Well,
that explains
a lot. Yeah, I'm very short-sighted. Without glasses or contact lenses, things look a bit like an impressionist painting.
I was in a hotel in New York recently and I was walking down a long corridor. At the end of the corridor, I saw this painting, which I thought, that is beautiful. Like a big, it was abstract, it was red and white and all kind of stuff. And I thought, when I get to the end of the corridor, I'm going to see what that is. And it was a fire hose. It was beautiful.
That would be a thoroughly irresponsible painting to hang in a hotel.
It would be. Well, Monet's unusual colours may be down to his cataracts, but he's not the only one. Digger probably had maculopathy, so it's a retinal disease that affects your central vision, and that explains the increasing blurriness in his paintings. And it is thought that Van Gogh suffered from lead poisoning, and that can make your retinas swell, and you start to see light in circles, so very like the Starry Nights. And Van Gogh also treated, of course, with digitalis for his epilepsy, and that drug can cause you to see in yellow or yellow-green, and that could explain his increasing use of yellow in later works. Anyway, if you let an optician test your eyes, then you need your head examined. If your surname is Farmer, what did your ancestors do for a living?
Pharmacists.
Good, pharmacists. Very good.
Very good. Very good. Pharmacists. No, what did they do?
I like that they call the drugs industry Big Pharma, don't they? Which always makes me laugh. So I always think of a Big Pharma.
It's not that.
No.
In the Middle Ages, a fermier was a tax collector. So early fermiers collected taxes for the crown, and they would pick applicants to work on tenanted lands. In time, they made money out of this. They began to buy land, they began to grow crops on it, and eventually they became what we know as farmers. The very first ever farmers, in our sense of the word, was a man called William Le Fermier, recorded in 1238. So farmers are actually tax collectors. Well, let's have a look at some other occupational surnames. Anybody know any of these? Osman.
Oh, well, that's a good one.
Yes?
If you go back a couple of generations, we were all charcoal burners in the New Forest.
OK, but it's anybody who works with bones, so it could be a rag and bone man.
Yeah. Oh, that's fun.
Yeah, so it's an Osman. Natch bull? It's somebody who hits bulls on the head to stun them before they get slaughtered.
With and they spoon. Do it with a huge spoon, yeah.
Yeah, massive spoon. What about a warner?
Is that a sort of health and safety inspector?
Is it someone who makes yellow cards?
Yeah. No. It's a football joke.
Football joke, OK. hang on 2 seconds. It's somebody who looks after royal rabbit warrens. What about a dick man? What do you reckon? It's somebody who digs ditches, a dick man. And a Kellogg.
Serial killer?
Yes. Yes, it is. It's a killer of hogs. It's a butcher.
Is an arkwright someone who makes an enormous boat?
An arkwright is a person who makes arcs, so chests.
So Noah's Ark, it was just an inverted
massive
chest.
Yeah. If your surname is Farmer, your ancestors were tax collectors. Name the greatest Wimbledon champion of all time.
Mm. Andy Murray.
I think I would have said Sampras. Sorry.
Sampras?
Great Uncle Bulgaria.
Is it a croquet player?
Oh. Yes! Oh, it is a croquet player. Oh, absolutely right. Professor Bernard Neal is the greatest Wimbledon champion of all time. He won the croquet championships 38 times. So if you think about it, Navratilova, Wimbledon singles 9 times. He won 38 times. He only took the sport up at the age of 40. Between 1963 and 2002, he won 37 titles out of a possible 40.
Smacks of a drug cheat, that.
Well, you have to press on the red button to get coverage of the croquet.
Okay, here, so... Oh. Alan, what colour do you want to be? Do you want to be red or blue or...?
Black.
Black, here we go.
Can I be the iron?
Which way are you going to go? You're going to go right, right?
I don't know why that has pleased me so much. It went miles.
Be under someone's feet.
Croquet, it was an Olympic sport.
It should be still.
It was dropped after 1900 because only one person turned up to watch. So. But the reason it's interesting is because the very first women to take part in the Olympics took part as part of the French croquet team. So there were 7 men and 3 women. And it was thought to be rather racy because it was a game where men and women played on equal footing. There's a wonderful quote from the American Christian Review in 1878, said croquet would lead to moral decline in American women, and consequences would include absence from church, immoral conduct, and eventually ruin.
True, though.
That's a very pessimistic view.
Anybody know the connection between croquet and Pall Mall, the great street in London?
Oh. They played croquet upon it?
Yes, they did. It is, in fact, where croquet comes from. An Italian game, 17th century game, called Palemale. And both Pall Mall and the Mall were designed specifically to play this game. They whacked the ball up the course and then they had to shoot a ball through a suspended hoop at the end, and that's where we begin
that's
to get
much more like
from.
Quidditch.
It is, yeah.
For people who play actual Quidditch. near where I live. Mm. They run around with broomsticks between their legs. None of them can fly.
That is what leads inevitably to ruin.
Yes.
So the name comes from the Italian palo malio, pala, ball, and malio, mallet. And it's where we get mall from, shopping mall. We get it from the mall and all those wonderful games. Mm. Can I have my things back, please?
I've lost the black, I'm sorry, it's gone.
Now, which oath do doctors swear before entering practice?
Hippocratic.
Yay!
They don't, it turns out.
They don't.
Yeah, I knew that they didn't. Doctor friend of mine said, oh, no, we don't.
No.
I was very disappointed. Yeah, we do what we like.
Yeah. We do cross all the way.
We do what we fancy. We know all the stuff and then we do what we like.
They do take sometimes an oath called the General Medical Council's Guidance on Good Practice. But the Hippocratic Oath that we talk about, they don't... Well, it's got some great stuff in it, the Hippocratic Oath. Don't have sex with patients, that kind of thing. You know, I think that's quite good. Don't remove the kidney or bladder stones. That's quite part of the Hippocratic Oath.
I didn't know the Hippocratic Oath was this specific.
Yeah.
I thought it was quite general, airy-fairy, try and do good.
No.
Airy-fairy, try and do good.
Yeah, yeah. If a patient is ill, try and make him better.
The bit you're thinking of is first do no harm is the thing most people think is part of the Hippocratic Oath. It actually comes from another part of Hippocrates' work. But, in fact, we don't even think he wrote the oath. It appears about a century after he popped up his own clogs. So it's probably one of his students. But the doctors in America do take a more modern oath. Does anybody know what it's called? It's named after a pasta dish.
Carbonara.
Ravioli.
The oath of ravioli, I like that.
The oath of bolognese.
The oath of bolognese.
Lasagna.
Yes, it's the oath of lasagna. You're absolutely right. Written by a doctor in 1964 called Louis Lasagna. At the end of all that, it is time for the scores. In first place, our employee of the week with -2 is David. Performing adequately with -5, it's Richard. On a final warning with -7, Deirdre. Clearing their desk with -49 points. Alan! And of course, we have a prize for our winner. This week's objectionable object is this lovely Queen Victoria milk jug. That's for you, David, because you can't have a show without prizes.
Lovely.
It only remains for me to thank Deirdre, Richard, David and Alan. Now it's time to clock out, and to encourage you all to leave, we've left a massive cheese in the car park. Good night. We'll be right back.